Welcome. Our Ogham Baptist Church pre-recorded online service. My wife and I are hosts today. My name is Dave Moss and this is my wife, June.
Hi everybody. We came to Ogham Baptist Church 3 years ago as visitors. We'd been meeting friends of ours in Ogham and they kept inviting us. And so we decided to come and give it a try. We've been here ever since. We love this church. People have been so welcoming, so friendly, and we feel completely at home here now. And we look forward to God doing new things when Tom arrives amongst us and reaching out to Ogham and the surrounding villages.
Today is a special Sunday in the church calendar. But more about that later. Also later, Neil Kirk will be giving us an overview of the Book of Obadiah as we continue to progress through the Minor Prophets. Leslie Shilton will be leading us in prayer. The OBC virtual band will be leading us with one worship song, two other songs we have selected from YouTube. We will have the kids' YouTube Bible story, which should give us a clue to what is special about today. June and I will return to close this time of worship with a blessing for the coming week. Heavenly Father, we do thank you that we have this opportunity of coming to praise you. We thank you, Father, that your word tells us that you inhabit the praises of your people. So Lord, now as we start our praise, we bring our thanksgiving to you and ask that you will bless this time together. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Spirit, fill my soul. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now there were staying in Jerusalem God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our own native language? Parthians, Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we all hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said, "They have had too much wine." Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. "Fellow Jews and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It's only 9 in the morning. No, this is what was spoken by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the great and glorious day of the Lord, and everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We've just seen how the Holy Spirit first came to the apostles in Jerusalem. Now, if we go to Ephesians 5, we'll see what Paul tells the church. "Do not get drunk, but instead keep on being filled with the Holy Spirit." Be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in songs and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Now let us go and join with OBC Virtual Band to enjoy When the Music Fades.
Appear. You're looking into my heart. It's all about you. All about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you. All about you,
Hello. Let us pray together. But before we do, I'd just like to say a little something about being separated, because in the past year or so, we've all been separated. Separated from so many things. We've been distanced, isolated, segregated. We've been kept away from our families, our friends, all our loved ones, and from the places that we know, that we regularly visit, our workplaces, our leisure places, our churches. We've become disjointed, for want of a better word, but we have. And we've been saddened. And so many of us have been isolated. And this has caused us to be confused. And sometimes it has brought us into conflict. However, it may be that because we have been isolated and separated, we've discovered new talents and gifts. I hope so, and I hope you're using them. Wow. But where will you be using them? In our lives, we have needs. And maybe we have seen the needs of others far more clearly. Hopefully we've seen that the vulnerable the elderly, the sick, all needed help, and hopefully we've been able to give our own gifts in giving and help them. Health and happiness has been a focus to us all, I'm sure. And maybe we've not really thought about our health too much before and how valuable it is. I hope that in the future we can help each other to keep healthy and happy. But who does this happiness depend on? Who do these talents and gifts belong to be able to be helpful in this world and help all those people that we've just talked about? Maybe we have a strong desire to reunite and to reconnect. Some of us may not. Some of us may be drawn the other way, that our quiet times are more valuable times. Maybe they're more valuable times with God. No doubt those who have never viewed life as being quite so fragile have seen over these last year or so that actually from day to day, from one day to the next, that we never should take our lives for granted. It's time to reconnect. It's time to be together. It's time to join. And slowly but surely this is happening. But who will you join with? Who will you grant those gifts and talents to? For me, I hope that I will reconnect more with God, because God has been the person who has kept me going through the whole of this COVID pandemic and has given me so many joys during the pandemic. Let's give back. Let's give back to God. If you've lost your connection with God because you've been in conflict, now's the time to reconnect. Now's the time not to be lost, but to say to God that you want to come back, to say to God that you want to give what you have learned to him. And that's very easy to do, because all you have to do is pray to him and ask him. Ask him where you need to be. If you haven't done that, do it. It's definitely time for us all to reconnect and grow, and to help God's kingdom grow too. Let's join in prayer. Dear Lord, take away our selfish pride. Make us humble and honourable to you. Rid us of arrogance and self-opinions. Fill us with more knowledge of your word and your instructions. Strengthen us with a faith and a wisdom that comes from listening and following you more closely each day. Fill us with your Holy Spirit so that we are armed servants for you, with a truth built from your teaching alone. May we be peacemakers and kingdom builders, so that your will may be done here on earth. We worship and adore you, Father God, and thank you that as your children, however many times we are broken, fearful, or stray from your side into our wrongdoings, you just continue to love us, build us up, forgive us, and draw us near to you in the safety of your unconditional love. Dear Lord, in you we trust, forever and ever. Amen.
The book of the prophet Obadiah. This is the shortest book in the whole Old Testament. It's a mere 21 verses. And at first glance, it does not look very promising. It's a series of divine judgment poems against the ancient people of Edom, which was a nation that neighbored Israel on the other side of the Dead Sea. However, there is way, way more going on here. So first, here's the backstory. The people of Edom were unique because they had a shared ancestry with the Israelites. They both belonged to the family of Abraham, who, with Sarah, had their son Isaac, who, with his wife Rebecca, had two sons, Jacob and Esau. Now, the book of Genesis told us the story of these two brothers, and to say the very least, they had a tense relationship. They each later received the names Israel and Edom, which eventually became the name of the families that descended from them. And these families replayed the same difficult relationship of their ancestors. Israel and Edom had enormous tensions throughout the centuries, but they still shared that family bond. And it's that bond that was betrayed and shattered in the tragic events of Jerusalem's fall to Babylon. So when Israel was invaded and conquered by Babylon, the people of Edom took advantage by plundering other Israelite cities and then capturing and even killing Israelite refugees. Now, in other prophetic books, God held Israel's neighbors accountable for this kind of violence. And so here, Obadiah does the same for Edom. The short book has two halves. The first part is a series of accusations against the leaders of Edom, specifically for their pride and self-exaltation. Literally, as they lived up high in the desert rocks, but also metaphorically, they truly believed they were superior to the Israelites. And it's that pride that led the Edomites to not just stand idly by when Babylon came to destroy Jerusalem, but actually to participate in the destruction. And so God says through Obadiah that Edom will be brought down from their height and destroyed. As they have done to Israel, so it will be done to them. Now, right when you think you're going to hear more about how Edom will meet its doom, the topic suddenly shifts in verse 15. We hear this, "The day of the Lord is near against all nations." Now, why do we all of a sudden shift from Edom now to all nations? This verse is a hinge piece, and it links the first half of the book to the second half, where Obadiah announces the day of the Lord, but not only for Edom. He widens his focus to include all nations. And Obadiah says that all prideful nations that act like Edom will face God's justice in the same way. They'll fall from their prideful heights and come to ruin. Now, the combination of these two sections, one about Edom, the other about all nations, shows us why Obadiah was so interested in this tiny southern neighbor of Israel. Obadiah sees Edom's pride and fall as an example, an image of how God will one day confront the pride of all nations and bring about their fall too. It's hardly coincidental that in Hebrew, the word Edom, or Edom, is spelled with the exact same letters as the word humanity, or in Hebrew, Adam. In Obadiah, Edom's rise and fall is a parable of how God's justice will one day oppose pride and violence among all nations in the day of the Lord. But as in all the prophets, God's judgment is never his final word. Specifically, remember the conclusion of the two books that came right before Obadiah, Joel and Amos. Joel had painted a picture of what will happen after the day of the Lord against all nations. He said that God would perform a new act of salvation in Jerusalem, and that all who humbled themselves and called upon him would be delivered. And in the conclusion of Amos, he said that after the day of the Lord has judged Israel's evil, God would raise up the house of David and build a new kingdom for Israel that would include Edom and all the nations called by my name. And so the book of Obadiah has been placed right after Joel and then Amos to expand on these very promises about the hope of God's kingdom over all of the nations. And so the book concludes with a very hopeful future. God says he's going to restore his kingdom over the new Jerusalem, that he'll repopulate it with a faithful remnant. And then from there, God's kingdom will expand to include all the territory and nations around Israel. And so this little book contributes to the larger portrait of God's justice and faithfulness that we're seeing in the prophets. The ancient pride and betrayal of the people of Edom becomes an example of the greater human condition, all of the ways that we betray and hurt each other and God's good world. But there's hope, Obadiah says. Edom's downfall points to the day when God will deal with evil in our world, but also bring his healing kingdom of peace over all the nations. And that's what the book of Obadiah is all about.
Good morning, I'm Neil. Literature is full of stories of families and clans warring and fighting, be that the Montagues and the Capulets, the Corleone family, or the Lannisters. Rarely will it end in reconciliation and harmony, but more often the outcome is tragedy and the futility of war. Today we're going to be seeing this as we continue our series traversing through the section of the books of the Bible known as the Minor Prophets. You might be wondering why I'm filming in the loft. Other than the fact it's the quietest room in the house, there is a reason, and I'll come on to that in a bit. Now, as you may be aware, I'm an accountant by profession, and so perhaps it's not surprising that I'm a bit dull and have a liking for efficiency and being concise. It's these latter reasons why Obadiah is one of my favourite books of the Bible. And as it's the shortest and most compact in the Old Testament, I'm pleased to be able to talk about it this morning. It's a mere 21 verses. Bonus points go to you if you manage to find it without using the table of contents at the front of your Bible. It's tucked halfway through the Old Testament prophetic books, following Hosea and Amos, and just before the adventures of Jonah. And unlike many of the minor prophets, there's no famous sound bites that draw readers to it, so it relies more on its central themes and messages to really be heard. As such, extra bonus points go to you if before this morning you could talk for a full minute on it without any repetition, hesitation, or deviation. In those succinct 21 verses, the book covers off many fundamental theological topics, including judgment, redemption, justice, future hope, deliverance, pride, suffering, and tolerating evil. Today, we're going to hone in on just those two major themes of pride and justice. So, while like our lovely Rutland, it might be small, this doesn't mean it should be overlooked and forgotten about. It has as much to add to the Bible as the other 65 books contained. For those of you alive in the 1990s, you'll probably be aware of the stereogram picture craze. For those not born before then, it consisted of a colourful picture, normally that looked just like random squiggles, that when you focused on it, at a point just before the picture, an incredible 3D image would emerge from it. It was the nearest thing to virtual reality we had in those days. I had loads of these pictures blue-tacked on my wall, and can remember sitting in my kitchen, aged about 12, perched on the edge of my chair, grimacing like a constipated puppy for about 30 minutes, eager to see the 3D picture emerge from the flat image for the first time. And in the same ways, the extraordinary 3D picture that did eventually emerge was well worth the perseverance, so is Obadiah's obscurity worth our attention. The fact that it is so often overlooked and ignored, when it is actually quite accessible, means it feels like some sort of exclusive secret, known only to a select handful. So I hope you're eager to dive into it today. To be able to appreciate the prophecy, though, context is key. Without knowing who the nations mentioned are, it makes trying to understand it like putting together IKEA furniture without the instructions or an Allen key in a room with no lights on. So to be able to understand who the Edomites were and why God wanted them gone, it is critical to know the story of Jacob and Esau, their ongoing and fraught relationship, and the hang-ups their descendants had felt towards one another for many, many generations, manifesting in several incidents over the ages. We need a full picture before we can even launch into the book. Now, while we've not got time to go into it in too much depth this morning, if you're not familiar with it in a lot of detail, I'd encourage you to go to chapter 27 of Genesis, get a cup of tea and a biscuit, and settle down for a good read for about half an hour or so. The story of Jacob and Esau is an exciting one. How they came to a superficial and temporary reconciliation, and how the differing nations that then grew around them each developed their own similarly tense relationship. We only need to see decade-old conflict in either Ireland or the Middle East more recently to know that the passing of time alone doesn't lead to reconciliation, but more often to actually further division. In the case, though, of these two tribes, of Jacob and Esau, they had a family connection and should have looked out for one another at times of need, being there for one another when they were struggling. Instead, what we know is that the Edomites descended from Esau, the brother of Jacob, took advantage of Israel's struggles and added to the burden. Rather than putting their arm around them in support, they pushed in the knife of opposition further. As the brilliant Bible Project video we saw earlier mentions, the Edomites had elevated themselves, both physically, by basing themselves at the highest point they could, and socially, holding themselves out as better than the Israelites and other tribes. They'd put themselves as being above the Israelites, thinking more of themselves and their own well-being rather than that of others. And it was their pride that was to be their undoing.
See, I will make you small among the nations. You will be utterly despised. The pride of your heart has deceived you. You who live in the clefts of the rocks and make your home on the heights. You who say to yourself, Who can bring me down to the ground? Though you soar like the eagle and make your nest among the stars, from there I will bring you down, declares the Lord.
So today, as well as it being quite fun up here, I wanted to position myself in as high a place as I could to show that actually, when we put ourselves up high, there's generally only one direction for us to go in, and that's down. We see that with Jesus so often in the Gospels. Those who want to be elevated are brought lower, and those who seek humility are raised up. An example is Mark 10:33, where the disciples are arguing about greatness, and earlier on in that chapter with Jesus rebuking those who ignore the importance of children. Then we have that glorious passage in Philippians 2, where Paul as writer encourages us to emulate Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped. Rather, he made himself nothing. That's the example right there that we have to follow. So there's an inevitability with the Edomites that at some point God is going to intervene and right the wrongs and dispense some justice. The message of Obadiah is that the Edomites would be inescapably and irrecoverably exterminated because of their unrepentant, remorseless stubbornness to turn aside from the ingrained prejudices and judgments and offer some love instead. God would wipe the globe clean of all Edomites and every trace of their bloodthirsty legacy. Have you eaten in any Edomite restaurants recently? Have you toured any holy sites in Edom? Are there any religious holidays observed by an Edomite remnant anywhere on the planet? Their conspicuous absence of all things is passive but potent proof that God's prophecy has been fulfilled literally. And what Obadiah shows us is that what was to happen to the Edomites isn't exclusively for them. The important link, verse 15, switches it from being about them, the Edomites, to what God would do for all nations.
The day of the Lord is near for all nations. As you have done, it will be done to you. Your deeds will return upon your own head.
So there's a stark warning there that applies to us too. Are we unknowingly being like the Edomites? Do we think we're justified to judge or condemn when we should be helping and getting alongside? Do we prefer to talk ill with people when we should be encouraging? Do we think of ourselves as more knowledgeable or more holy or more wise than others? Do we think so highly of our own opinion that we're willing to hurt others by forcing it on them? We might do this openly and blatantly, but more often it's cleverer, more subtle than that. More often, the pride is hidden in gossip, in bad-mouthing others, imagining the worst in other people's actions, looking for ways to lower others so that we might look higher and better. It's in the old, did you hear what so-and-so said to so-and-so? Or the reluctance to examine our own lives and motives before coming to conclusions about other people's. We all need to be reviewing daily and examining ourselves and looking to follow the example that Christ has set us. Moving on to our next focus. We all have an inbuilt sense of justice and wanting a guilty party to get its comeuppance. Dick and Alison mentioned this last week within their sermon as well. We love it at the end of a film when the baddie is made to pay for their crimes while the protagonist walks off happily into the sunset. And conversely, we feel shortchanged when at the end of the film, not everything is put right. Examples would include Thelma and Louise, Titanic, The Wicker Man. The endings there aren't quite what we hope they're going to be. For me, I enjoy watching, and this is a weakness of mine, Alan Sugar on the BBC lord it over his arrogant apprentices, waiting to see their pride take an inevitable tumble. I suspect that makes me just as guilty as everyone else in this issue. Conversely, I always find it excruciating when I have to see humble people who try hard set upon by those who possess big egos and little grace and really struggle not to intervene to stand up for them. The Edomites' behaviour was completely out of order. And God couldn't allow it to go on. And as we've seen, he went on doing what he said he'd do. The Edomites were purged and Israel was restored.
There had never been, but on Mount Zion will be deliverance. It will be holy and the house of Jacob will possess its inheritance. The house of Jacob will be a fire and the house of Joseph a flame. The house of Esau will be stubble. And they will set it on fire and consume it.
For me, that deep ingrained desire for justice that each of us feels so innately is a clear neon lit sign that we're made in God's image. that our desire for justice is the same as God's, that our hearts beat like his in this area. God goes on to vindicate the Israelites, as he says he will in Obadiah, and repeatedly brings down those who oppose them cruelly, whether that be the Edomites or some other opposition. God restores justice and makes things right again. Sometimes that justice takes longer than we might want, but it will come. Isn't that reassuring? Doesn't that want us to make sure that we're on God's team for when that will happen in our own lives? As well as this, Obadiah is a book about hope. It's a fact that life happens while we're making other plans. And the longer life goes on, the more chance there is that something bad will happen. No one lives to be 100 years old without experiencing loss and grief. The more we live, the more we will have moments of despair and hopelessness when it feels like all of our plans are for nothing. Through the way that God intervenes to support and comfort the Israelites and give them a future hope, Obadiah teaches us that in the midst of life's most challenging moments, we have a God who hears us and gives us hope and a comfort to keep on going.
This company of Israelite exiles who are in Canaan will possess the land as far as Zarephath. The exiles from Jerusalem who are in Sepharad will possess the towns of the Negev. Deliverers will go up on the Mount Zion to govern the mountains of Esau, and the kingdom will be the Lord's.
God wants to draw near to us whenever we open our arms to let him in. Through Jesus, we have an eternal hope of a life in a restored relationship with him. That's encapsulated so well in John 3:16. It says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him may not die, but have eternal life." So in closing, I want us to take away two primary things this morning from the book of Obadiah. I want us to remember that pride comes before a fall, and God really struggles to use us when our pride is bigger than our humility. Let's not place ourselves higher than others, where we can be brought lower, but instead make ourselves humble, just like Christ did. Secondly, I want us to remember that God always offers us comfort and hope, even if people let us down, which they will do continually. That's a fact, unfortunately. Don't allow that to distract you from the truth of God's love, which is unfailing, and his justice, which will always prevail. Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for justice. Thank you that there are consequences for our wrongdoings, as the Edomites found out, but that you, through Jesus, these consequences have been met. Help us to throw aside our Edomite tendencies for pride, for judging, and for attacking others, and instead help us to follow Jesus' example and put others' needs above our own. Help us to remember that everyone is fallible, including ourselves, and therefore help us to be daily aware of how reliable you are in comparison, and help us to copy your example in all that we do. Amen.
How do you explain? How do you describe a love that goes from east to west and runs as deep as it is wide? You know all our hopes, Lord, you know all our fears. Words could not express the love we feel, but we long for you to hear. So listen to our hearts, hear our spirits sing a song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. Words we know to tell. tell you of our love. Just listen to our hearts. If words could fall like rain from these lips of mine, and if I had a thousand years, I would still run out of time. So if you listen to my heart, every beat will say, thank you for the life, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. And listen to our heart,
oh Lord, please listen.
Hear our spirit sing,
and hear us sing
a song of praise that flows. Tell you what an awesome God you are. But when words are not enough, tell you of our love. Just listen to our hearts. Listen to my heart, every beat will say, thank you for the light, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. And listen to our heart,
oh Lord, please listen,
hear our spirit sing. Song of praise that flows,
a song that flows
from those you have redeemed,
those you have redeemed.
And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. But when words are not enough to tell you of our love, just listen to our heart. Words are not enough to tell you of our love. Just listen to our hearts. Listen to our hearts.
Oh Lord, please listen.
Listen to
that brings our time of worship today to an end. Our thanks goes to all those who helped and those who joined as well. If you're a visitor and you would like to know more about Oakham Baptist Church, then there'll be a screen that comes up after we finish, which will help you to contact us.
Now we'll close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have been with us today and will remain in our hearts by your Holy Spirit. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now, this week, and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Love you.
Bye.